Connecting Point is brought to you by Inspiration Interiors and Dr. Ken Yasuhara.
Connecting home, business, politics, relationships, and life to the Bible. Relevant answers for today's issues. This is Connecting Point with Pastor Wayne Cordero.
On Christmas night of 1996, John and Patsy Ramsey's young daughter was slain by an unknown killer. This tragedy was to become one of the most notorious unsolved mysteries of our time. Coming up next, we'll meet John and Patsy Ramsey, who will share their hearts, their grief, and their faith. Stay with us for this very special interview right here on Connecting Point Live.
Are you dreaming of whiter, brighter, straighter teeth? Dr. Ken Yasuhara can give you that dream smile.
Hi, I'm Dr. Ken Yasuhara. I've seen smiles enhanced by cosmetic dentistry, and I've seen lives transformed by the self-confidence they've gained by having a great smile.
Call 947-8900 to schedule a complimentary consultation. And let Dr. Ken Yasuhara make your dream smile a reality.
Where do you end up after endless miles of running? After countless hours of training and a lifetime of sweat, standing with champions. Where do you end up with drugs and alcohol? Nowhere.
This segment of Connecting Point is brought to you by Douglas Engineering Pacific, Hawaiian Island ENT Specialists, and Century 21 Lewis Real Estate.
Nearly 10 years ago, 6-year-old JonBenet Ramsey was found murdered in her home. Although there was no evidence that the parents were involved and charges were never filed, unprecedented media coverage served to convict John and Patsy Ramsey in the court of public opinion. While grieving the loss of their daughter, they endured persecution, suffered the loss of their job, their home, and their savings. In all of this, they continued to battle cancer that threatens even now Patsy's life. Many of us would shake our fists at a God who would let this happen, but their faith only grew stronger. Tonight, John and Patsy Ramsey join us to share their story and their faith in God, which has sustained them through their darkest of days. Would you please welcome with me John and Patsy Ramsey? Welcome, them, would you?
John, please, have a seat.
Thank you.
Now, you both have put out a beautiful book here called The Death of Innocence, and this is about the whole ordeal that you went through. Tell us a little bit about JonBenet. What kind of a girl was she, and a little bit about the background of all of this.
She was just fun. She was gregarious. She was always wanting to put on a show and entertain you. And we'd have friends over for dinner, and she'd come down and have orchestrated all the little kids into a little entertainment act after dinner or something.
Now, so you'd lost another girl right before that, too, John.
We lost our oldest daughter, Beth, in 1992, and JonBenet was two. And one thing that was so meaningful to me, even though she was only 2 years old, she really sensed that I was hurting and grieving, and she latched onto me like glue, and it just it was just a neat feeling for me.
Now tell me what happened. There was a ransom note left in your home.
We got up early that morning, the 26th, to we were to leave to meet with our older children
in
Minneapolis. Christmas time. It was the day after Christmas. Patsy came down, found a ransom note at the base of the stairs, and screamed, and our life changed from that moment on.
How much did they ask for, John?
$118,000, which was a bizarre number.
Why that amount?
Don't know. We don't know. There's been speculation, but it was was a very strange part of the ransom note.
And then how many days later did you find her body?
Well, the note said, I will call you tomorrow. And I didn't know if tomorrow was today or tomorrow was tomorrow. And I thought, my gosh, I can't wait till tomorrow. I can't stand that. But so we waited. And then finally, the police asked me to look through the house thoroughly. And I found her in the basement about 1 o'clock in the afternoon.
In your own home, mm-hmm. In the basement.
Yes.
Now, after this horrid ordeal where your daughter Beth dies, mm-hmm. and then JonBenet is found murdered in your own home, all of this must have taken a huge toll on both of you. And yet, with all the agony, the police focused on you guys.
They did, and I was to learn that the police always focus on the parents initially. Of course, we were in the house, and even though we were shocked at that and dismayed, we thought, well, okay, we understand that, but please don't just focus on us. We accept that, but don't limit it to that. And sadly, in this country, statistically, I think 68% of the time it's a caregiver that's involved in such a tragedy. But you have to cut that one more slice. And in almost all of those cases, all of those 68% of those cases, almost all of them, there's a long history of problems that are well known to the police and the social services and the schools and so forth. And of course, that wasn't the case in our case. But we were shocked, but we accepted that. At the time.
Now, both of you were people of faith before this took place, and Patsy, when that happened, did you say to God, I mean, how would you let this happen to us?
Well, I think by human, we are human, and we want to ask why. I mean, I can't sit here and tell you I didn't ask why, and why my child? You know, it always happens to someone else. Why my child? But we had a track record with God by that time. We'd lost Beth in the car accident that just rocked our family. Then a year and a half after her accident, I was diagnosed with stage 4 ovarian cancer, and God healed me from that. And so we knew God to be faithful regardless of the circumstances. And I think had the ordeal with JonBenet happened prior to those two events, I think it would have just devastated me beyond compare. But because I knew God to be faithful and that he said he would never leave us or forsake us, that even though I had the why questions and was just grief-stricken beyond description, he just saw me through.
Kidnappers want to kidnap JonBenet? I know she was in a lot of pageants. She was a pretty little girl, and she had kind of the cover girl face, you know, the little child. It's beautiful. Do you think that worked against her, that kind of publicity?
Well, see, people say, well, she was so famous, so you know, but nobody knew that. I mean, truthfully, we hadn't done the pageants very much. I mean, a lot of this one pageant that we went to had a lot of different categories in it. So you were in sportswear, western wear, you know, party wear. So it looks like, but that was one event, you know, one weekend event that we went to.
And the audience too were grandparents and parents.
It wasn't there were a big, 8 or 10 people thing. In the room.
We were told by John Douglas, who's was the fellow that started the FBI profiling lab, a very brilliant man, that he spent a lot of time looking at it, and his best assessment was that it was someone that was either angry at me or jealous of me, and that's a hard pill to swallow, because I can't imagine anyone being angry with me, or certainly that angry. But I respect his judgment. So
John,
that's
do you think
the
it was
best
just a kidnapping that went bad.
That's what the best detectives have told us. They said, you know, don't read any more into it than is there. And they said, in our opinion, it was a kidnapping, that something went wrong.
What were some of the myths that the media spun that would put you on trial?
Well, probably the first one, in fact, we wanted to make that the title of our book, was No Footprints in the Snow, and that got out there immediately. And of course, we lived in Colorado, and it was winter, but and I hadn't really noticed. I did remember that coming home that evening, there was no snow in the yard or the driveway.
Christmas Eve.
But then we saw the crime scene photographs that were taken early that morning when the police first arrived, and there was no snow. And so that was the fact, but the fiction got out, no footprints in snow. And as someone said once, when you have a rumor like that, it's like shouting fire in a theater. As everybody's running out, you can say, ooh, just kidding, but they don't hear that part. It's too late. And that, to me, was probably the first thing that got out in the media. And what was interesting too was that the national media was taking information from the local media. So if that came out in the local paper, the local radio station, that immediately got picked up by CBS or ABC. And so it very quickly spread.
Now, you were on
wildly.
Barbara Walters and some others.
We did an interview probably 3 years after this happened. We, for most of that, well, for all of that time, we just didn't really talk to the media. Barbara Walters was the first interview we did. I think that was in 2000 or 1999.
Now, you have a son named Burke. Mm-hmm. How did he fare through all of this? Because he lost his older sister, Beth. And then JonBenet, mm-hmm. he's right in the middle.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, God has just had his hand on him, and that's been our constant prayer, is that our children, our three living children, would see how we have overcome this horrible, not just the tragedy of losing the children, the girls, but the aftermath that was so horrific. And every decision that we made was made on his behalf. We no longer were able to live in our home anymore. So we lived with some friends in Boulder for about 6 months until he could finish the fourth grade. And then we moved back home to Atlanta, Georgia, where our extended family lived. And he finished part of his schooling there. And then we moved to Charlevoix, Michigan, where he finished and graduated high school.
How's he doing now?
He's doing beautifully, thank you. He made the dean's list his first semester at college, and he's studying computers and is just a brilliant young man.
We're very proud of him.
Now, it just seems like you've gone through so much, almost like Job, and we're gonna take a break, John, and when we come back, I wanna ask you about how you parallel with Job and how God delivered Job and maybe how God delivered you. Stay with us. We've been talking with John and Patsy Ramsey, whose daughter JonBenet was found murdered in their very own home, and they were the ones accused for the murder and how their faith pulled them through. We'll be right back in this very special edition of Connecting Point Live. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
2 days. 5,000 worshipers, one God. Glorify, live worship with New Hope Christian Fellowship. Feel the power. Experience the joy. Share the moment. CDs and DVDs are available at the New Hope Bookstore or online at www.enewhope.org.
How far can a dream take you? Well, it's taken me to new places and new experiences. How far can a song take you? To the end of the rainbow and to new dreams. How far can drugs and alcohol take you?
Nowhere.
Connecting Point is brought to you by Pomaikai Transport Services Incorporated, Clean Sweeps Incorporated, and Doctors Kin Ching and Lynn Fujimoto.
Welcome back to Connecting Point Live. We're here with John and Patsy Ramsey, the parents of JonBenet, that was in the media for so long of a time. And we've seen some of the background on the media, but it's not always what's the truth, is it?
No, it's not. I've learned.
Now, how do you fare with that when you see things in the media that you look at and you say, that's not true? What do you do? I mean, is there any recourse?
It's pretty tough. It's as Benjamin Franklin said, it's tough to pick a fight with somebody that buys ink by the barrel. But it's extremely frustrating, and you feel powerless, and but very difficult to overcome.
Patsy, you just pray a lot during that time? What do you do?
You cry. Just grit your teeth and pray for the salvation of those people. I tell you what, I mean, it really has taught, I mean, our friends and people that we know, and our son's friends, who of course were very young when all this started happening, to not take carte blanche everything you read and see on the news, because they are just trying to sell newspapers and television time and advertisers. It's all about money, and it's not about truth. It's about who gets the get first. You know, if they haven't quite checked a fact, they will go with it because they know in 10 minutes CNN's going to come on with it, so they want to get it first. And it's all about ratings. I mean, we would without fail get invited for the spring and fall ratings, because the ratings would soar, you know, when we were advertised to be coming on their show. And I mean, they just, you know, it's all about money. So you have to just pray for discernment, and I have to pray that these people will get their just rewards, and we know with our God.
Yeah, it just seems like it's excuse the expression, but morbid for someone to take the death of a beautiful child and then spin it in such a way as to make money off of it, really not caring about the emotion and the pain,
not
just about the money. And you're caught in the middle of this whirlwind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was the hard part, I think. There's one Denver Post editor that actually stated that he thought this case had entertainment value. and that just hurts, and it shouldn't be that way. So I think it's a big challenge for us today to understand, where do we get accurate, non-biased news?
John, as I said, you seem to me like Job. You know, you've lost, you know, your home, your savings, your funds, your job, two of your children. Besides Burke, your wife, you had very little left.
I'll admit I've read Job, and it's a pretty fascinating story. And of course, the whole test of Job was, did he still have faith in God without all his assets and family and so forth? And of course, he had it much worse, I think, than I did. But there's a wonderful discovery, for me anyway, that I found in Job. And if you remember, at the beginning of the story, Job is said to have, and I forget the exact numbers, but 3,000 cattle and 2,000 sheep and 7 sons and 3 daughters. And then, of course, at the very end of the story, God restores Job's wealth and possessions and family twofold. And it relates that now he had 6,000 cattle and 4,000 sheep and so forth, so on, 7 sons and 3 daughters, and then the story ends. And if you notice that, the question I asked was, well, why didn't God give him 14 sons and 6 daughters, which would have been twice as many as he had in the beginning? And I think the answer would have been that, Job, you have 14 sons and 6 daughters. 7 and 3 are with me. And it was the most wonderful thing that I discovered in the Bible, I think, for me, having lost 2 children, to see that consistency in Job, which is one of the oldest books of the Bible, written before Jesus came along and told us that of eternal life.
And maybe just a hidden message, as it were, that God gave him back 7 sons, 3 daughters, and said, now I've doubled your children. It's just 7 sons and 3 daughters are with me. You haven't lost any.
You haven't lost any.
And here's 7 and 3 more.
Yeah, it's a wonderful reassurance, I think, of Jesus' promises to us. And this is, to me, an incredible thread of accuracy through the Bible that had that been written by man, he would have written, and God gave Job 14 sons and 6 daughters. That's what you would have expected in that story. But to have had that detail and that consistency with what Jesus promised us, to me, was just, it was so reassuring to me that yes, I do know my daughters are with God.
Mm-hmm. Patsy, you speak at different women's groups, etc. Tell me about your faith. How are you different now? I know it was shaken, but how are you different now from when it was before JonBenet's death? What has it changed in you? Has it changed for the better, for the worse? Are you softer, tougher?
Well, I'm just thankful that we do not grieve as those who have no hope. I mean, we have hope of life eternal in Jesus. And without that, I would never see JonBenet again. But because I believe in the death and resurrection, and that we will again be reunited, it gives me hope to get up in the morning. It's just everything. It is just everything. When you have nothing left, but you know I have children on this earth that need me, and I love, and I have a job to do that God has given me to do, and I try to listen for that daily. But I know, and of course I'm going through cancer again, and I don't know how long I'll live. God knows. And until that day, I will profess his name to everyone I can. But I know that when I'm absent from the body, I will be at home with the Lord. And JonBenet and Beth and my mother, who has since passed away, and you know, all the fun people are starting to be over there. So it's going to be a glorious reunion. You know, no offense, sure. Anybody. It's going to be a really great day.
John, tell me, how has it changed your faith? You know, because you take a look at it, your wife has cancer. She's going through therapy now. And you lose Beth and then JonBenet.
And you say, what, have I sinned? What have I done?
Well, I certainly examined that, I guess, in my head when we lost Beth in great detail. And it was a struggle for me to, and for me anyway, that my faith kind of went from my head to my heart. And then when we lost...
Tell me, what do you mean by that?
Well, I'm an engineer by education, so engineers have to prove things. And if you can't prove them, then it's not true. So I'm left-brained, logical. And so I've got to think through, well, you know, what about the resurrection? What about things that seem impossible to us, yet we read in the Bible? Is God really real? Does he really care about me every day? Those kinds of questions. Is this a punishment to me? And I had to answer intellectually all those questions, I think, and got very comfortable with them. And you know, they say, and the Bible tells us, faith is a gift. But I still had to kind of analyze it, and then move past that to where I believed, and I didn't have to analyze it anymore. But for me, I think the thing that changed the most, and I've noticed anybody I've talked to that's gone through a tragedy, their faith changes.
Yeah.
It doesn't stay the same.
That's right.
Some of them fall away. They give up on God. They say, well, how could a wonderful God, you know, loving God, allow this to happen? But for me, the key was, and because we were so unable to control or to affect what was going on around us, that I learned to trust God. Not only have faith in him, but trust him with my life. Mm-hmm. And that was kind of the final step for me in my faith, and God tells us that he is trustworthy and that we should trust him.
But, and he is.
And he is. We've seen it so much in this last 10 years.
Wow.
But that was the big change for me.
You guys have gone through so much, and your faith is still shining, and it just amazes us. It exhorts us, it encourages us, it challenges us. When we're going to close, but we're going to continue this again next time. And I want to ask you about the fact that if you ever found out who did this, would you be able to forgive them? And we'll talk about that. But for now, we want to just say thank you for encouraging our faith and helping us to be people who trust in God. Thank you from all of us at Connecting Point.
Thank you
for being with us. We love you.
So much.
Yeah. Tell them thank you, would you?